smack in the middle of America. Now, it gives me no pleasure to say that. It's my former hometown. I have enormous love for the Windy City, but particularly when it comes to violence, it's not an exaggeration to say that it is a third world reality. Let me show you this very troubling statistic about children in Chicago. According to the Chicago Police Department latest data, so far in this year of 2021, 261 children have been shot in the city of Chicago. 41 of them have died, and it is only September. Now, Chicago, I want to take this conversation to an area of gun control and gun deterrence of crime, because Chicago, mind you, has some of the strictest gun laws in America. The fact that it is as violent as it is shows you that clearly those gun laws do not work. Now, what might work? One thing would be actually having firearms in the hands of responsible citizens so that they can deter crime. My next guest has a lot to say about that. He is John Lott. He is the president of Crime Prevention Research Center. He's an extremely prolific author and, in my view, probably the foremost authority on the Second Amendment and on crime prevention in America. So, John, you wrote this excellent article at Real Clear Investigations. There are far more defensive gun uses than murders. That here's why you rarely hear of them. Listen, I knew there would be more defensive actions than murders, but I didn't expect this that you cite in your article. You say that the stats indicate that there are 4 to 5 times more defensive uses of firearms as committed to criminal uses of firearms.
Right. I mean, I think academics have known that for a while. Look, most people who rely on the media are only getting a very small part of the story. We looked at the 5 largest newspapers in the United States so far this year. They've had a total of 10 defensive gun uses that they've shown between the 5 publications. And at the same time, they were showing over 2,700 crimes where people were either killed or wounded with guns. Anybody who thinks they're well informed by watching the news media would think that guns are very rarely used to defend people, that they're almost always used to go and cause some type of harm. And I can't blame them. But what makes a story newsworthy doesn't necessarily reflect what happens in reality. I'll just give you one simple example, and that is, we know from research that's been done that about 95% of the time that people use guns defensively, they merely have to brandish a gun in order to go and stop an attack. By contrast, if you look at the news stories, only about 4% of the news stories of defensive gun uses involve brandishing. And most of those involve cases where somebody using a gun has held the person there until police arrived. And that's simply because it's not as newsworthy for an outlet to go and say, you know, a woman brandished a gun, the criminal ran away, no shots are fired, nobody killed, and we're not even sure what crime would have been committed.
Sure. No, it's obviously not as compelling of a story. And there's a phrase that's unfortunately true, right, in the media, which is that if it bleeds, it leads. And when you stop bleeding, when you stop a crime in progress with a firearm, unfortunately, that's not nearly as juicy a story. But it's an important one, which is one reason why I'm glad you wrote this article. And it's also a reason that we on this show are going to make sure that we talk about the importance of the Second Amendment and how often you lay the stats out terrifically, how often really law-abiding Americans do use firearms to defend themselves. John Lott, I thank you so much for writing, and thank you for joining us tonight.
Thank you very much.
You bet.